Pleased to say joining me on the line now is Dr. Sharon James, who's a social policy analyst for the Christian Institute. Morning to you, Sharon.
Morning, Frances.
Do you think, I mean, can you see some merit in some of these arguments that are being put forward? If it means ultimately that actually you can, particularly if you've got children, if you can go through a sort of a fairly quick process like this, the finances get sorted fairly quickly and you can end up having a decent relationship with your former spouse afterwards, you know, that's going to be sort of a happier situation all round, isn't it?
Frances, this is an absolutely dismal proposal, and I really, really resonated with that text you got from Dave just a moment ago, because he was absolutely right in that if a delay had been in the procedure, it could have been that a relationship could have been saved. At the moment, the cooling-off period saves 10,000 families a year from splitting up. In other words, 10,000 families a year abandon divorce proceedings precisely because there's that cool-off period, that waiting period. And to make the whole thing easier is simply going to make a bad situation worse. We already have among the worst divorce rates in Europe because there's been successful liberalisation of the law. And this proposal won't strengthen marriage and families. It'll make the situation even worse.
You said, obviously, there's an increased divorce rate. We seem to be seeing that exponentially every year. Ultimately, I guess the only people who are really going to benefit from that are the family lawyers, the solicitors, who will end up obviously getting paid for it, albeit they might be trying to work out things for the best of each client. So ultimately, if you're not getting that involved in it as well, then making it simpler on in that sort of scenario, and possibly being still on speaking terms with your former spouse afterwards, there's got to be something in that as well.
Not at all. It's been lawyers that have pushed divorce reform over the last 50 years. And every time the divorce law has been liberalised, the effect has been a dramatic increase in the number of broken families. So from on an average about 24,000 a year in 1960 to 151,000 a year in 1987. And now about 42% marriages already end in divorce. And the word on the street is, oh, this makes things better for children in conflicted situations. In fact, the most thorough research that's ever been done on that showed that counterintuitively, actually, divorce doesn't end conflict. And very many children find themselves going on living through the conflict between the two divorced parents. And then in addition, often having to adjust to reordered or reconfigured families. And all of this is highly stressful, so much so that a leading family law firm got fed up and actually published a book in 2016 describing divorce through the eyes of children, giving their testimonies, and it makes for an absolutely dismal read. Divorce doesn't always end the problem.
What about those parents? I mean, we heard from Ray a short while ago, Sharon, saying that she was in a relationship with a husband who was continually unfaithful, you know, fairly abusive through the use of alcohol, and she didn't want her kids being brought up in a marriage where they thought that was acceptable behaviour from a man. I mean, you know, that you can have some sympathy with that. I mean, we can't just be anti-divorce, can we?
There are high conflict situations and tragically situations of abuse where a divorce is necessary, and that's why we have a divorce law. But where there are low conflict situations, it's actually very often, this most detailed survey to date showed, children are worse off after divorce. So we must have fair divorce law for situations where there is abuse and other genuine fault causes. But what is being called for is a completely no-fault situation where people can walk away quickly for trivial reasons. And as I say, at the moment, the procedures in place to make it more difficult lead to many families being saved. And when you ask children what they want, the majority of children desperately want to grow up with both their parents. So I think that we have to say we need to be reforming the law in the opposite direction, creating a situation of greater family stability where we will have fewer children going to bed tonight without one of their natural parents. At the moment, nearly half of 15-year-olds are without one of their natural parents, and that is a situation that is deeply, deeply troubling.
OK, Sharon, thanks very much indeed for your contribution there. I really do appreciate it.